The title of my sermon this morning is The Great I Am, Part 1, I Am Who I Am. And this morning is going to be the first of what I believe are going to be 8 sermons that are going to eventually make their way through Jesus' 7 I Am statements in the book of John. But before we get into the book of John, I figured that it was important for us to kind of gain an understanding of the significance of how Jesus says, I am, by looking at Moses' interaction with God at the burning bush in Exodus chapter 3. I have always thought that it was harder not to believe in God than to believe in God. That's just kind of my opinion. Like, the idea that we're to say that there is no God just leaves so many question marks. And to me, having God as my fallback, in a sense, you know, God is the answer to all my questions. Where if I didn't believe in God, I'd have a whole lot of questions unanswered. But sadly, a lot of people still reject our loving Lord and Savior. Earlier this week, Tabitha gave me she sent me a text, and it was something from Facebook, so you might have seen it. I thought it was kind of powerful, really, so we're going to go ahead and play this little video.
Okay, we're done.
Yes, thank God for that.
God?
What do you mean?
Who in this day and age still believes in God?
Well, I do. Why's that?
Well, you obviously missed all the wars, the devastation, the poverty, everything that goes wrong in this world.
Well, I don't believe in dentists. If there are dentists in the world, why do so many people have broken, infected, and missing teeth?
Well, I can't help people that don't come to me to have their teeth fixed.
Exactly. It's the same way with God. It's a bit rich for us to expect God to help people who don't come to Him, and instead insist on doing things their own way.
And how am I meant to come to God?
Just talk to Him. He's listening.
I mean, the bottom line is we have an amazing, loving Heavenly Father that wants nothing more than a relationship with us. But if we're not willing to seek Him out and go to Him, it's useless. And like I said, that's the majority of our world today, I would say, is turned away from God, turned away from the Creator. This morning, I want to take a look at Moses' interaction with God and at the burning bush on Mount Sinai. And in doing so, I want to try to gain a little bit more of an understanding regarding our Heavenly Father. But before we do, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, I praise You and I thank You now. I ask that You put a special touch on me as I proclaim Your word and as we study through it, Lord. Allow me to do only what You want me to do. Allow me to say only what You want me to say, Lord. Allow me to focus on You and You alone. And Lord, I ask that everyone else here, including myself, partake in Your word today. And we praise You and we thank You in Your wonderful name. Amen. If you have your Bible, turn to me to Exodus chapter 2. Really just turn to me to the beginning of Exodus. We'll go from there. If not, there are Bibles underneath your seats or in the seats in front of you. And we're going to try to get a pretty decent understanding of a context leading up to the burning bush. So, book of Genesis ends with Joseph and his family, Jacob, more specifically Joseph's father and his family, making the way to Egypt and settling there. And earlier we read, Beverly read, that there were 70 total people in this crew that, along with Joseph, made the way to Egypt. For a while, everything went well for the children of Israel. But after the generation that was Joseph and his brothers had passed away, the people of Israel started to multiply. And the king of Egypt forgot, or did not know, is another way of putting it, about the arrangement between Pharaoh and Joseph. This new king decided to enslave the people of Israel in order to keep them under control. Despite their enslavement, the people of Israel continued to multiply. And as a result, the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. And that's the 12th verse of the first chapter of Exodus. In an attempt at population control, the king of Egypt decided to have 2 midwives who were Hebrew kill off all the newborn baby boys. These 2 midwives, because of the fear of the Lord, chose to disobey the king's orders. The king found out and questioned them about their refusal to kill the male newborn children. The midwives told Pharaoh this, and this is from the 19th verse of the first chapter of Exodus. Hebrew women are not like Egyptian women. They are vigorous and give birth before the midwives arrive. As a result of their faithfulness, these 2 midwives were blessed by God, and God showed them kindness, protecting them and giving them families of their own. But Exodus chapter 1, verse 22 says this. Then Pharaoh gave this order to all his people. Every Hebrew boy that is born, you must throw into the Nile, but every girl may live. So around the same time, a Levite woman was married, who was married to a man from the house of Levi, gave birth to a son. For 3 months, she hid this boy. But when the child became too big, she got a papyrus basket for him and coated it with tar and pitch. Then she placed the child in it and put it among the reeds along the bank of the Nile. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. As this child was in the basket, as he floated down the river Nile, it eventually arrived at Pharaoh's daughter and her entourage who were bathing in the river. Pharaoh's daughter called for the basket, opened it, and found this Hebrew baby in it. The sister was waiting nearby and asked, "Shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you?" Of course, she found the Hebrew baby's the mother, the child's mother. In Exodus chapter 2, verse 10 says, "When the child grew up, she took him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses, saying, 'I drew him out of the water.'" Now turn me to Exodus chapter 2. I'm going to read verse 11 all the way down to verse 25 as we gain a context here, like I said. So Exodus chapter 2, verse 11. "One day, after Moses had grown up, he went out to where his own people were and watched them at their hard labor. He saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his own people. Glancing this way and that and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. The next day he went out and saw two Hebrews fighting. He asked the one in the wrong, 'Why are you hitting your fellow Hebrew?' The man said, 'Who made you ruler and judge over us? Are you thinking of killing me as you killed the Egyptian?' Then Moses was afraid and thought, 'What I did must have become known.' When Pharaoh heard of this, he tried to kill Moses, but Moses fled from Pharaoh and went to live in Midian, where he sat down by a well. Now a priest of Midian had 7 daughters, and they came to draw water and fill the troughs to water their father's flock. Some shepherds came along and drove them away, but Moses got up and came to their rescue and watered their flock. When the girls returned to Reuel, their father, he asked them, 'Why have you returned so early today?' They answered, 'An Egyptian rescued us from the shepherds. He even drew water for us and watered the flock.' 'And where is he?' he asked his daughters. 'Why did you leave him? Invite him to have something to eat.' Moses agreed to stay with the man who gave him his daughter Zipporah to Moses in marriage. Zipporah gave birth to a son, and Moses named him Gershom, saying, 'I have become an alien in a foreign land.' During that long period, the king of Egypt died. The Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out, and their cry for help because of their slavery went up to God. God heard their groaning, and he remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. So God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them." So Moses' life is typically broken down into 3 different 40-year periods of time. The first 40 years was his time in Egypt, from his upbringing to his status as a young adult until he eventually killed the Egyptian soldier, or Egyptian slave master, or whatever you want to call him. The next 40 years after Moses departed Egypt are him in Midian, where he got married, had children, and took care of Jethro, which we're going to find out is the name Reuel took after Moses came around. He took care of his flock. And then finally, we have the final 40 years of Moses' life, which are the 40 years of the Israelites in the wilderness. So pretty much from the Exodus, the point that he drew them out, until they hung around in the wilderness. And as you see on the map, something interesting. You see Midian, and you see where Egypt is. That Sinai Peninsula is the wilderness that the Israelites were in. So Moses was somewhere in there. And as we're going to find out, he's going to be at the mountain of Sinai, or Mount Sinai, in a moment when we get into that. So the people of Israel have more or less forgotten who their God was, forgotten about God, because they felt that God had forgotten them. But they are about to find out a little bit more about this God. They're about to be reintroduced to an amazing and loving Father in heaven. This all began when Moses interacted with God at the burning bush, which is, like I said, what we're going to focus on today. And the question I want to address is this: What can we learn about God from Moses' interaction with him on Mount Sinai at the burning bush? And I'm going to make 3 points. They're in your bulletin as well, so if you want to follow along. Number one, God deserves reverence. God deserves reverence. Look at Exodus chapter 3, and let's read verse 1 down to verse 6. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1 down to verse 6. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, meaning God, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. So I think it's kind of amazing to think the contrast between the first 40 years of Moses' life as a prince of Egypt to the next 40 years of Moses' life as a shepherd out in the middle of the desert. Major differences. And I would say a truly humbling experience. Moses has experienced what it was like to be royalty, and now he's experiencing what it's like to be on the bottom of the barrel. I mean, because again, we're going to learn in the coming weeks as we study more of the I Am statements that being a shepherd was not a job that many people wanted. I mean, it's just the kind of job you just, I'm okay, I'm going to go do something more respectable. I mean, being a shepherd was not a clean job. You smelt like sheep all the time, and it just didn't work out. It wasn't a very pleasant job. But while tending Jethro's flock, and again, he changed his name from Reuel to Jethro for whatever purpose over the 40 years that he got to know Moses. So as he's tending to the flock, he's searching for grassland for them to graze on. And again, in the desert, this was difficult. So he had to go a long distance. So he found himself quite a ways away from home at the foot of Mount Horeb, which is eventually going to become Mount Sinai, which is where the Lord gave Moses the Ten Commandments. So in the next couple of years, probably more than a couple of years, at some point in the next decade, I'd say, of Moses' life, he's going to be back at Mount Sinai and he's going to interact with God once again, which is quite amazing to think that this is where it all began. So Moses was doing his thing when he noticed a bush burning, but that bush wasn't burning up. Verse 2 tells us that the angel of the Lord was within the bush, and Moses realized that the bush was not burning up, so he wanted to investigate, which is, I guess, what I would do as well. Now, most of my commentaries said that they believe that the angel of the Lord is more or less a reference to God. This is saying God is there. But oftentimes, we believe that the angel of the Lord also refers to the pre-incarnated or the pre-human Jesus Christ, the pre-human Messiah. I don't know if I want to go to that extreme. I think there's not enough information to tell us for sure. But this is kind of my rationale. If we're to say that God and Jesus are one, you know, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost, aren't we to say that all three of this Trinity, the Godhead, was within this burning bush? So to say that Jesus wasn't there would be wrong as well. So the point is that there's something within the bush, which is God. God is within the bush. God is causing the bush to burn without being burned up. So upon approaching the bush, the Lord spoke to Moses, and Moses replied. God then told Moses, do not come any closer. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Which, I mean, I think I would be very similar. Like, if God started speaking to me from a burning bush, I would have had very similar reactions. So nothing about the ground Moses was standing on was holy, by the way, too, other than the fact that God was upon that ground. That's something I want to emphasize. Because I can imagine just in this day and age even how people would worship locations. And there's no reason to worship the location, because it wasn't the location that was holy. It was the God upon that location that was holy. Then, as if Moses needed any more information. So, you know, God is speaking to Moses. So as though Moses needed any more information to prove that he's speaking to God, God identifies himself as the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. He is the God of Abraham, or of Moses' ancestors. So what does this mean for us? And here's really the question I want to address for this first point. Do you approach God with reverence and respect as though he is the God of all the earth, the creator of all the earth, our Savior? This is from the Life Application Study Bible. I thought this was kind of a good statement. Taking off his shoes was an act of reverence, convening his own unworthiness before God. God is our friend, but he is also our sovereign Lord. To approach him frivolously shows a lack... Shows a lack of respect and sincerity. When you come to God in worship, do you approach him casually? Or do you come as though you are an invited guest before a king? And I kind of something I was thinking about is how, you know, I mean, if we were ever invited to go meet with the president... And I mean, I'm not the president's biggest fan. You know, I don't agree with a lot of what he says. But if I was invited to go visit with the president, I'd probably give the guy some respect because of the office he holds. I mean, a king or a queen, especially back then, essentially held your life in their hands. If they decided they wanted you gone, guess what? You're gone. I mean, Henry VIII had 6 wives. Most of them didn't make it to the end of their marriage. You know, they had their heads cut off or something bad happened. I mean, and this was it. Everyone who didn't agree with the king was done away with. In a similar way, we need to have the same fear and respect or this reverence with our Lord and Savior in heaven. I mean, God is, I mean, he's our friend. He wants to have a relationship with us, but it's more than that. He's God. He's the creator of everything. He didn't have to save us. He chose to save us out of his love for us, so we need to do something about it. Keep your finger here. Turn to me to 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles, so the end of the Old Testament. Not too far past it, though. Before the book of Psalms. That's really not the end of the Old Testament at all. The middle of the Old Testament. So before the book of Psalms, chapter 29. So 1 Chronicles, chapter 29, starting at verse 10. So just like we had to dust off Deuteronomy before, we should probably dust off 1 Chronicles. So 1 Chronicles, chapter 29. We're going to read what David says, pretty much his prayer to the people of Israel right before his death. So 1 Chronicles 29, verse 10 down to verse 13. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, "Praise be to you, O Lord, God of our father Israel. For everlasting to from everlasting to everlasting, yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give thanks to give you thanks and praise your glorious name." Job, who had every reason in the world to curse God, chose not to. And what he says in Job chapter 42, verse 2, Job says, "I know that you can do all things. No purpose of yours can be thwarted." Then Psalm 33, verse 6 down to verse 9 says, "By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, their starry hosts by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the water of the sea into jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm." And then finally, Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7 says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction." When Tabitha and I were in San Diego, one of the things we got was a pass, like a seasonal pass for the San Diego Zoo. And we enjoyed going there. Cameron was young, so it was kind of like we get to walk around, push Cameron around in the zoo. And Cameron and Tabitha always liked the giraffes, which I just kind of thought giraffes were boring. I like the bears, you know, the grizzly bears. Talking about just seeing a big grizzly bear. And what's really, to me, I think what makes the grizzly bear amazing is that, you know, you can almost look around in the United States and find them. You know, you can find a bear in the United States. I can't find a giraffe that's not in a zoo in the United States. Despite my fascination with the grizzly bear, I had no plans of climbing into the grizzly bear's cage and getting to know that grizzly bear any better than I do from the distance I have. I ain't going to go pet the bear. because I have a healthy respect and fear of that bear. In the same way, we should have that respect for God. When you come before the Lord in your time of worship, whether in this corporate fashion like here or when you're by yourself, do you come before Him with fear and respect, the fear and respect He deserves? Don't just read your Bible as though it's just another book full of words. Don't just sing songs as though you're at some sort of a concert. Don't just pray as though you're talking to someone on the phone. We have a God who's an amazing God, and we need to treat Him like He is Lord of all the earth, which is what He is. We need to give God the reverence He deserves because He cares for us, which is my second point. So we need to give God the reverence He deserves because He cares for us. Look at Exodus chapter 3 once again. Let's read verse 7 down to verse 12. So Exodus chapter 3 verse 7. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. So God has seen the misery and the sufferings of His people. And again, it's been 300 plus years since the Israelites have really communicated with God. And God has not forgotten them. They thought that God forgot them, but that's not what happened. What I find powerful, though, is not only did God see the misery and see and He was concerned with their sufferings, but God is going to act upon it. He's going to do something. You know, we just read that He says, I have come down to rescue them. Divine intervention is about to take place. God has come down to earth, which is kind of funny thinking, God, that's what Jesus did as well. Rescue is also could be translated deliver. The New American Standard translates to deliver. And it comes from the Hebrew word natsal, and means to snatch away, deliver, rescue, or save. God's rescue of the Israelites is twofold. One, He rescues them from their enslavement and bondage in Egypt. And two, He's bringing them to a land that is good and spacious, a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, the Bible Knowledge Commentary says this. The phrase, a land flowing with milk, means that Cana was ideal for raising goats and cows, meaning a good pasture land. The goats, sheep, and cows were full of milk. Like feeding on a good pasture land, the goats, sheep, and cows were full of milk. Flowing with honey means that the bees were busy making honey. Milk and honey suggested agricultural prosperity. This is the first of numerous references in the Old Testament to the land flowing with milk and honey. And of course, the land that we're talking about is the land of Israel, the land that the Israelites will eventually make the way into and that they're, I guess, partially currently at now. Verse 9 and 10, God has heard the cry of the Israelites and has a plan to rescue them. And guess what? That plan involved Moses. Unfortunately, Moses wasn't as excited about that plan. He was a little bit apprehensive. His response, as would be mine, was one of inadequacy. Who am I? Who am I to have the God who is obviously an amazing God, a God that he has not communicated with in a while? I mean, they believed in God, but I think my point is that they lost their culture. They lost their understanding of who this God was. But my emphasis here is that Moses is now being called in said God telling him, hey, go back to Egypt. You're the one that I'm going to use to release the several, I would say, at least a million Israelites out of Egypt, despite the fact that they're currently enslaved to the Egyptians. And Moses is like, me? And I think I'd react the same way, but guess what? Verse 12 is just unbelievable. Moses was not alone because God was with him. Look at verse 12, and God said, I will be with you. Moses was not alone, and not only was he not alone, he was with the best possible person in the world to be beside him. I mean, he's eventually going to have his brother Aaron help him out a little bit. And fortunately, Aaron, as much as Aaron was probably a very good speaker, which is why he helped Moses out, God is a much better individual to have with you, is really my point here. So Moses has God beside him because God cares for Moses. So God cared for the Israelites. God sees their misery and he's acting upon it. God recognized Moses' concern regarding God using him to save the people of Israel. Guess what? God cared about the Israelites. God cares about Moses and God cares about you too. And that's what, to me, it's just such an amazing thing. Because us as sinful people have done nothing to deserve the love of God. But God has given it to us anyway. Psalm 55, verse 22 says, "Cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken." 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6 and 7, Peter writes, "Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you." Then Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, Paul writes, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." And then I would say one of the most powerful verses in the Bible is Matthew chapter 11. Jesus says, chapter 11, verse 28 down to verse 30. Jesus says, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." You know, a yoke is essentially the thing that goes around like an oxen's head. You know, there's usually the two oxens and what goes around their shoulders, and the oxens are pulling whatever load they have. Jesus is not saying that we are going to be completely, he's not taking all the load on his own, is really what I'm getting at. He's taking one half, but it's nice to know that Jesus is right next to us when we're struggling through our hardships. In the same way, this is what's happening with Moses. God is saying, "I'm going to be right there by your side." You know, when you're facing Pharaoh and Pharaoh's intimidating, you know, when you're saying these things that aren't going to make any sense to Pharaoh, when all these plagues are taking place, I'm right there. I'm right next to you. I'm going to be with you. Finally, John chapter 16, verse 33, Jesus once again says, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you have trouble," or tribulation is another word, "but take heart, I have overcome the world." We have a God who's overcome the world. I mean, nothing can get in our way. There is nothing that can get in our way because God cares for us. That's it. That's the bottom line. It might seem difficult. We're going to have to carry some of that burden. I mean, Jesus has taken half of it with us. We're going to face hard times. I mean, the Bible says it. You know, we are going to face temptation. But with Jesus on our side, it's going to be a whole lot easier. So thus far we learned that God deserves reverence and that God cares. Now we will learn from Exodus chapter 3 and Moses' interaction with God at the burning bush that God is the great I am, which is my third and final point. God is the great I am. Back to Exodus chapter 3. Look at verse 13 all the way down to verse 15. Moses said to God, "Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you.' And they ask me, 'What is his name?' Then what shall I tell them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you." God also said to Moses, "Say to the Israelites, Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation." So like I said, it's been a good 350 years since the Israelites have really had an opportunity to interact with God, not necessarily for any reason than the fact that they were enslaved in Egypt. They felt that God had forgotten them. They felt that God had gone. But that's not what took place. God was there. But the point I'm getting at here is as a result of their interaction with the Egyptians who worshiped multiple gods, they wouldn't recognize Moses as God, really. I mean, they knew that, I think they had an understanding of who God was, but they didn't have the personal relationship with God that their forefathers did, that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had. And that's kind of what's taking place here. So Moses asks, what should I say your name is? And in verse 14, God answers Moses by this: I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you to me. I am comes from the Hebrew word haya and means to be. It means become, to come to pass, exist. So that's if we understand what this is saying. So God is saying, I am. And what he's literally saying is, I exist. This is clearly pointing to the creating ability of God as well. It's really what I'm also thinking here. God caused everything to be. Douglas K. Stewart, the author of the New American Commentary, the Exodus edition, says this. He wrote, I am who I am was probably heard by Moses as I caused to be because I caused to be, thus making I am more accurately translated, I caused to be. So if we really understand what God is saying, God is essentially saying that I am, I exist, I've always existed, and I created everything that exists. That's what he's emphasizing here. And this is what I find even more powerful in all of this. Remember, I mentioned Yahweh in verse 15. Yahweh is essentially the Hebrew word for Lord, the Lord. And we say Yahweh, and if we read the Hebrew word for Yahweh, you can read it two ways. Either Yehovah, which is where we get Jehovah from, or Yahweh would be the other way. Hayah is the root word. So Hayah meaning I am is the root word for Yahweh. So really what God is doing, he's almost kind of doing a word play with Moses here. I am is really like a part of Yahweh. It's kind of, I don't know if that makes sense. So really saying I am means he's saying I am God. I am the Lord. I am Yahweh. So God is telling Moses that he is to be called Yahweh and that he is the same God of his ancestors of long ago. Now, like I said, throughout history, and especially at this point that we are in the book of Exodus when it comes to Egypt, civilizations have believed in and followed many different gods. And I did some research. The Greeks believed in 12 main gods, the Olympians, but they ended up having thousands of gods whom they worshiped. Not thousands, hundreds is probably more likely. The Romans had a similar list of gods, very similar gods whom they worshipped. So a large number, I counted 40 different Egyptian gods whom they worshipped throughout their history. These are a lot of gods, and I think it'd be easy to be, you know, if Moses is thinking that the Israelites are going to want to know who this god is, because they think there's multiple gods. Not that they necessarily believe in them, but who's the god that spoke to them? And that's why he's having this conversation with the Lord. But the point I'm trying to get at is this. Moses has heard of many different gods in his lifetime, but now the one and only true God is reintroducing himself to Moses and to the people of Israel as the God. Yahweh is the only God who can be credited with the creation of all the universe. Yahweh is the great I am. So let me close up now. John chapter 1, verse 1 and 2 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God." And that's a clear reference to Jesus. Jesus was in the beginning with God. Jesus was there in the beginning for the creation of the universe because Jesus is God. Jesus was there in the burning bush when he addressed Moses because Jesus is God. John chapter 1 verse 14 says, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Jesus was there when mankind needed a Savior, meaning Jesus was there when mankind fell in the garden, when mankind continued to sin since then. Jesus was here on earth. He lived a perfect life. But then Jesus also took the sacrificial death that needed to be made for us so we can be saved. When he died on the cross to forgive us of our sins, but then he rose from the grave, conquering death, because Jesus is God. Jesus is the great I am because Jesus is God. That's the essence of all of this, the essence of my whole point and where I'm heading with this for the coming weeks. Like I said, over the next several weeks, we're going to study the I am statements, and the significance is that Jesus is saying, I am God. That's really what he's getting at here. In making these statements, he's putting himself in the category of God, which a lot of people who are skeptics don't want to admit that, because when you admit that Jesus is God, you got to believe what he says. Jesus is God. So our God, the great I am, was willing to die for us on the cross. And that's to me, that's something that I don't think I can truly ever understand as a human. He's God. He's creator of everything. We think about kings, right? We talked about it before. the king would never come and sacrifice himself for his kingdom. That just would never happen. It doesn't make sense for that perspective. But that's what our God did. Our Creator, our loving Heavenly Father, came to this earth in the form of Jesus, died on the cross to forgive us of our sins, but then conquered death and rose from the grave so that we can be reconciled with God and be in heaven when we die. Do you have a relationship with the great I Am? And that's the essence of it all. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That means that every last one of us are sinful. Every last one of us are separated from God because of that sin. And the Bible also says the wages or the cost of sin is death. The penalty that needs to be taken place is death. And God could have allowed us to take that penalty. He could have cast us into hell. But that's not what He did. He came to this earth and He took the penalty for us. And because of that, we can turn to Him. Because of that, we can rely on God and call Him our great I Am. So this morning, it is my call on you that if you have never accepted Jesus, that you turn to Him today. But even more so, maybe you've accepted Him, but you've fallen away. You've walked in another direction for whatever purpose. My favorite Bible story is when Peter tries to walk on water. You know, Jesus is walking towards him. Peter tries to go out. He thinks he can do it. And then he does it in the beginning. He takes a couple steps. But then he realizes he's standing on water. And he starts to sink. If I was Jesus, I mean, Peter's being doubtful. Just let him sink. But that's not what Jesus did. He reached down and He grabbed him. And the same thing happens to us as Christians. We have a God who loves us so much that even when we make mistakes, He still loves us. God loves you today. Because He is the great I Am, and we have a Heavenly Father whom we can have a relationship with. Because of this, I hope that settles upon your heart now. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, I praise You and I thank You now as we come to You, as we close now, Lord, and as we try to comprehend all of this. I mean, You are God. You know, You are Yahweh. You are the Lord of all the earth, Lord. You are the Lord who made everything, but You're also the Lord who came to this earth and died for our sins upon the cross. But then You rose from the grave. Because again, You're God and You can do that. You conquered death. You made the sacrifice. But then You conquered death so that we can not only be forgiven of our sins, but we can also be saved and sent to heaven when we die. So Father, I just ask that we turn to You, Lord. No matter what situation we're in, turn to You in our times of need. Turn to You in our time of just in our longing for a Savior, Lord. I thank You for being the great I Am. And as we get into these seven I Am statements, Lord, I ask that You truly bless us as we study them and as we try to understand the significance of each statement and the significance of what Jesus said in making each of these statements. So, Father, now I praise You and I thank You in Your wonderful name. Amen. Amen.